Hello and welcome to another episode of the Trash Talk Podcast. I'm LJ, the Middle F, Smokey Rameriz from the Trash Talkers. How are you doing?
I'm doing good, doing good. It's finally cooling off here, so we're not in hell anymore in America or in the South America. Actually, it's already getting fairly cool up north, but I think we still have like a somewhat of a heat wave coming in maybe next week, so that's not going to be fun, but other than that, doing really well. How are you, JJ?
Yeah, I mean, the entire Northern Hemisphere is cooling down. It's actually also getting colder around here, although we were already like past peak cold anyways, like last time I had you on, but I've actually like had the windows open and I was like, oh, it's getting a bit chilly. Like when there's actually like a little bit of a breeze going by, something, it's like, ooh, like it's not like cold, but it's like about room temperature. And then when the wind comes in, can actually get kind of cold, especially in a shirt and a t-shirt.
It's amazing here because last winter we had the polar vortex, and then we have the super El Nino that we're in right now and continuing throughout the end of the year. We actually had the lowest temperature recorded ever in Georgia this past winter, and then the hottest, I don't want to say the hottest single temperature, but the hottest month ever recorded.
Yeah.
As for a whole month.
Yeah, I think we had, during the summer, I think we had like the, I think it was like the 5 hottest days that I had ever recorded or something, all happening within the same week. And it's like, oh God.
Yeah.
Crazy. So it was something like that. I don't remember what the exact time was, but it was something like that, where it's like, it might have been like the 3 hottest weeks and 5 weeks or something. I don't remember exactly, but it was something like that, where it's like, oh yeah, no, we didn't just beat the record once, we did it like multiple times back to back.
Oh yeah, yeah. We gotta call up CERN and tell them to stop messing. I know CERN does it. What is it? Which one controls the weather? The organization that all the conspiracy theorists like to point to.
I mean, that I do know that that apparently CERN is supposed to be responsible for the Mandela effect.
Mandela effects, yeah, with the Hadron Collider, yeah. Oh man, it'll probably come to me when we're off camera, but yeah, we'll have to tell them to stop with the weather modifications.
Yeah, but today we're not here to talk about CERN or the weather. We're here to talk about Area 51 and the aliens.
Yeah, definitely.
So you brought this up, right? There have been a lot of hearings, I think, in different places where people have claimed that aliens are, in fact, not just real, but they have, in fact, landed on Earth. And no one noticed. So, well, I mean, some people might have noticed. But we wanted to talk about that. I guess the first question is, what do you think? Are there aliens on Earth, living or dead?
That's the question, man. I mean, I really don't know what to make of it, because speaking of conspiracy theorists, now, you know, there's been people pushing for disclosure for all these years. They're like, we have to have disclosure. It's this huge conspiracy. They're keeping it from us. So now we finally get, it's what seems like the government agreeing, like, yes, here's your disclosure. They're here. We have their crafts. We have seen these beings. And now people are like, hold on. I don't believe anything they're saying. They're covering something up. And I think that's the nature of conspiracy theorists. Like, whatever the official narrative is, they have to be contrarian to that. I don't really know if there are other beings here or not, to tell you the truth. But I love the thought of it, because, I mean, well, actually, I love half of the thought. The half of the thought that they are here to enlighten humanity and move them along into this raising into the fourth dimension or whatever. But there's also the other side that they could be hostile and they want to take over Earth. So I like half of the idea that they are here.
Okay, so first of all, I don't believe that intelligent alien life exists on Earth. I have to be a little bit careful with this, because it is possible that alien life exists on Earth. And as far as it is theoretically possible that meteorites could carry microbial life and that could have found its way on Earth at some point. And so we could have life forms descended from aliens, technically. As a matter of fact, it is theoretically possible that all life on Earth actually originates from, like, single-cell life forms from outside of Earth. But all of that is very fringe and still unlikely, but intelligent aliens, I feel like we would have known. And if they were here for conquering, we definitely would know. Because if they have the technology to come here from far enough away that we couldn't detect them, then they also have the technology to, like, control us if they want to, right? Like, they will be able to, like, I don't know, stop our weaponry, you know, like, blow up anything they want, right? Like, if you have that type of traveling, well, I mean, on Earth, we kind of have that thing. I mean, I don't know how it would develop in other worlds, but you develop a technology, and it basically immediately gets used for war. Or you develop it for war and then later find civilian applications, right? Like, nuclear energy versus nuclear bombs. Like, it's the same underlying principle. And so, if they have warp drives or whatever, then they would also have warp cannons or whatever. And, you know, that, or warp bombs or, I don't know. But...
yeah, absolutely. If they're able to travel in thousands of light years across the galaxies, then, yeah, they have weapons that we cannot stop. And that's what a lot of people are worried about. But I want to go back. You were talking about the transpermia. And a lot of people believe that there is this society either inside of the Earth or in the middle of Antarctica, right? They believe that's where the aliens are at. So is it possible that transpermia happened and this meteor landed in Antarctica and they are surrounded by this life wall, by this ice wall, that life might have developed in a whole different way, just completely separate from the rest of the world?
I mean,
there may be some intelligent beings living there that we don't see.
Developed separately, possible, yes. No one discovered it, less likely, especially if you talk about, like, very complex, multicellular, possibly intelligent life forms. Like, I feel like someone would have figured this out. And this is, again, right, we talked about this before we started recording. Conspiracies are so hard to cover up. Like, okay, you want to assassinate some, like, leader in South America? Like, sure, right? We can cover that up. It's just the CIA doing it. You know, Henry Kissinger said it's a good idea. And, like, also the populace doesn't really care. But if there's aliens, like, the chance that just one single government would have found them and then covered it up is pretty minimal. And while, of course, you can say, like, there are a lot of countries that are friendly with each other that would maybe cooperate in something like this if they thought it was for the greater good. But, like, everyone... So if you had... I mean, Antarctica, right, is like, the perfect place for those sort of conspiracy theories because no country owns it. And, like, the only way to get there is if you're a scientist and you have something to... if you have some science to do there, right? Like, I mean, I think there are some other ways, but, like, for the most part, that's sort of the, it's more of a research place. And so you could hide things there theoretically, but also all sorts of countries are sending people there to do research. And none of those people, nor their governments ever went to the public and was like, hey, so by the way, we found something really freaky there. So yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. Well, Admiral Byrd said that he saw, I guess, a city or at least some kind of civilization. But, they, you know, that's just one pilot. And whether or not he's to believe, be believed or not. But there are tourist events in Antarctica, if I'm not mistaken, that you can actually book a flight to tour. I mean, really, I don't know what you would be touring. You just walk around on the ice or something and visit their facilities or whatnot. But
I think it's also mostly guided tours, and then every conspiracy theorist ever will be like, well, yeah, they don't show you the exciting stuff. So
they're exactly
really help the argument. Yeah. But also,
right, well, that's another thing. Oh, go ahead.
I was gonna say, you said underground, right? That's in some ways more plausible, but I still don't believe it.
Yeah, I mean, well, Jules Verne wrote Journey to the Center of the Earth. He believed there might have been a whole, human civilization, but creatures like dinosaurs still alive in the center of the Earth.
Yeah, I haven't gotten that far yet. I think the part where I'm is that just, like, started in Iceland, so I haven't finished reading that one yet, but... But what was I going to say? Right. The idea that maybe, like, a meteor impacted and, like, there's, like, it like landed and, like, went in the ground, like, some soft earth or, like, immediately over a cave opening, like, where, like, something, like, end up underground, covered again, and there's like some microbial life that then develop to be like, I don't know, worms, right? Like insects, maybe like mm-hmm. something like fairly small, on the simpler side, especially worms, for example, would be like, and then just existed in that, in like an enclosed environment that hasn't interacted with the outside world is very possible. And we've, as a matter of fact, we found a cave that had a very unique ecosystem where it was also like closed up at some point. And
yeah,
I think the water in there was like very sulfurous or something like that. It was like something really weird, and like very unique life forms developed there that are very adept for that environment. Now, all reasonable theories suggest that those just developed from related species that we have found on Earth, right? They are close enough to other species that we can have a good guess about where some of those came from. But there were like snails down there, right? So that have adapted to that environment. So fairly complex life forms. Mm-hmm. And so the idea that if an alien life form lands on Earth, like accidentally, right? Like the Transformia thing where it's like probably single-celled, not very complex, and then develops in an isolated environment, it's very possible. It takes forever to become intelligent, so unless it like landed on Earth around the same time that life force still up here anyways, it probably wouldn't be intelligent, especially in a much more limited environment where the less complex the environment is, the less complex the organisms will be. I don't think it's like an exact rule of evolution, but there were these experiments where they used I think it was bacteria of some sort, and they like try to see how they adapt to like different environments by having them in like petri dishes, and like I think they put sugar and something else in there, and like some subset of them actually evolved the ability to consume the other thing in there, but also all of them simplified over time because there just wasn't like anything of like, oh yeah, recognizing your environment or something isn't very useful when your environment is just like a sugar solution, like. And it's always that. So you don't need to respond to stimuli as well. And so that costs you energy. So they simplify. And that's also why some people don't believe in evolution. Like, well, yeah, evolution can take things away, but they can't give you new things, which is not how that works. But because those controlled experiments usually will simplify the environments, and you find that the organism becomes simplified as well. So if something developed on Earth, unless it developed out in the open, it wouldn't have become as complex as human beings, presumably. I mean, if you have like a large enough underwater cave, I guess some like dolphins could theoretically maybe happen, but I mean, not dolphins exactly because in the air, but like something, I mean, dolphins are pretty intelligent. They developed in, I guess from a human perspective, it seems like a less complex environment. It's hard to say like how complex the actual environments are. I mean, the ocean is much more complex than most people get the credit for, but I do think it's it would have to be a pretty large environment for different types of life to develop that then would in turn require certain adaptations, speciation, like niche partitioning, right? The sort of stuff. I find it hard to believe, right? The better arguments would be something like, oh yeah, and I don't know what evidence we have to the contrary here, so I'm not an expert, but certain things like, oh, maybe like fungi are just entirely alien, right? Because they seem kind of weird, which is the first thing where people are like, well, fungi, right? They're weird. And I don't know if we found the last common fungi animal ancestor, or even a common ancestor at all, that would prove that fungi are related to animals, which logically they should be based on like how they're structured. And they are in some ways similar to other Earth life, who suggest they're alien, but we also don't know which aspects of life are universal. So it's possible that like some fur fungus like landed on Earth like a million years ago and all fungi are descended from it. I'm not saying it's likely, but from what I know, that is possible. But also, again, I don't know if there is like the fossil record to prove that it isn't. It might well be.
Yeah, definitely. That made me think of something, though. Speaking of evolution of these beings, do you know about the stoned ape theory?
Oh, that apes developed intelligence because they got high?
Yeah, exactly. A lot of people believe that it was mushrooms, you know, and that spiritually the mycelium is like this neural network of the entire earth. So it actually almost is enlightenment growing in this fungus. And the apes came across it, and that's how they developed their brains. That's how they became smarter and evolved over time was through ingesting hallucinogenics. And but anyway, there's other theories that people have on what these beings are, and I wanted to get into a couple of those before we wrap it up. What are the chances that these are interdimensional beings, which would explain why they really didn't have to have, I mean, I guess that theory kind of goes out the window now that I'm thinking about it, because if you have their crafts, why would interdimensional beings need crafts? But I mean, it would make sense how they could travel throughout the universe in a given amount of time.
I mean, if you look at fiction, right, people have explored those sort of ideas. And we obviously, there is no actual like real world physics that we can necessarily point to support this. But there are oftentimes these ideas that is like traveling between worlds, right, between dimensions, that sort of thing, is actually dangerous. And so you need some sort of vessel to encapsulate you, just to like keep whatever's out there inside, maybe like have a force field so that it doesn't get torn apart by the interdimensional forces, whatever, as you shift over. And so it does make some degree of sense that it would have craft of some sort. But I mean, in the same sense that you have spacecraft, right? In fiction, also often have time machines, right? Like those, I mean, the very first one, I think the H.G. Wells time machine was like a physical object that traveled with you. I mean, if for nothing else, then the fact that you can get back, right? I mean, I guess if you're saying they're like literally biologically so that they can shift, obviously that would be different. But if you, even if you had a device that could open a portal to another world, having something on you that could bring you back would be very useful.
Yeah. Or unless they are ascended beings that can just do it mentally rather than, like, they don't even need a carbon life form anymore. They have ascended beyond this to where they're basically just in a, they're dimensional beings that we can't even fathom or see because we haven't ascended to that level to be able to understand that yet.
Yeah, but then you're like, that, okay, that's, so what have people seen, right? Like, you can't see or understand them. It's like, right? Because you, with the UFO things, right? You want to explain UFO sightings. You want to explain various things that have been found that mostly have been disproven, right? But a lot of the UFO sightings oftentimes don't have an official explanation. And they, I mean, there are good reasons for it, because oftentimes they're like just vague descriptions where it's very hard to come up with any sort of explanation because of just how little data you have to go off of. But we'd want to explain those, right? And sometimes, you know, like weird lights in the sky, sure, right? That could be like some fourth dimensional being reaching out and it glows, sure. But the UFO thing, you generally want to explain unexplained aerial phenomena that people have witnessed. And of course, the correct answer is A, imagination, B, hoax, and C, Russian / Chinese spy planes and balloons and whatnot, right?
Yes.
Now, the problem is, right, I said earlier, if they were keeping a huge secret, someone would have come out since. And the answer is, people have come out. We just don't believe them. And that's sort of the difficult thing because I don't think anyone has ever come out that is, like, credible enough to, like, or enough people have come out that were systematic enough to where I would have reason to believe it. At the same time, obviously, the argument is that those people get actively discredited, which makes sense if you're trying to hide something. So, I was a little bit torn on like the conspiracy stuff as like a sort of broad concept, but a lot of those that would require like, you know, like the Russians, the Chinese, and the Americans all to keep quiet. It's like, honestly, actually, those might be the countries that would keep quiet. Maybe not because they cooperate with each other, but because they also all love hiding stuff from populaces.
But yes, like, exactly.
But like European countries that tend to be at least a bit more open, right? I mean, Americans actually, in some sense, like with FOIA, they do actually have some pretty good mechanisms for like getting certain stuff, but also it's like, not if it's classified. And which... But yeah, no, I find it hard to believe that everyone in the world, like every government and every space agency and whatnot, would try to hide alien life. And then, so you'd have to argue that it's fairly rare, and that only a couple have discovered them and have maybe independently thought to keep them hidden. And that is like the question of like, why is it rare, right? If aliens are capable of coming here, I mean, I guess if they don't come back, then maybe that's the reason why you don't send more. But like, Also, why did they crash in the first place, right? I always find it fascinating when they're like, oh yeah, these super advanced aliens made it all the way to Earth. And then they crashed.
Yeah. Yeah. I tend to think if they had the capability of moving across galaxies, or even within one galaxy, if they can go light years, then they probably have the technology to also view and understand our world remotely from their world. Because we can look at something that's 100 light years away and tell if there is carbon or CO2 or methane or whatever on that planet. You would think they have better capabilities than we have.
That could be complicated. I mean, you could send a drone, definitely. But so what we see, obviously, as people like to point out, if it is 100 light years away, we also see it as it was 100 years ago. Which, if you can travel faster than light, becomes a problem, right? Because then you land and it's like 100 years later than what you observed, and Earth looks quite different. So in that sense, I mean, 100 light years is probably not that much. But in that sense, not the way we observe things, like even high resolution imaging and that sort of stuff wouldn't help. But if you can send a manned spacecraft there, you could probably send an unmanned one, or even just a manned one that like scans a planet from like, you know, the moon, like that sort of like a distance, scans it, does whatever they want, goes back, reports before they decide to like send people to land.
Well, one more thing that I wanted to touch on also, and this one I find very interesting because there's no way to discredit it at all. But a lot of people believe that it could be futuristic humans. It is us from the future returning to the past for whatever reason that we need that information in the future. What do you think about that one?
I mean, if you're saying that human beings stay fundamentally the same, right? So that like they could walk among us and we wouldn't know because they are us. Then obviously, that is very hard to disprove. I mean, the question is, what would their time travel devices look like, right? I mean, It's a thing, right, where if they like send it back Terminator style, right, where it's just like a naked person lands in the desert somewhere. Probably not in the desert, but like, you know, like that. It's like, okay, what are you gonna do, right? They're a human being inside and out. You know, they didn't take anything with them. And they're here to change the past. Like, how would you tell? And I mean, obviously time travel, the question is time travel possible at all? We don't know. There are our arguments of why it should be possible, mathematically speaking. There are arguments why it shouldn't be possible, logically speaking. You know, like the whole grandfather paradox stuff, where it's like, you can't really work out how that would resolve. Now, there are suggested answers to those. How persuasive you find them, I would have to leave after everyone individually. But that is interesting. I mean, then it's like, if you're saying they're coming with craft because you found the craft, then there's like, okay, we found it, we don't know how to use it, we hid it somewhere. I can kind of see that. That would also explain why a lot of them tend to land in the US, right? Because it is, in some ways, one of the most influential countries in the world. And so I can
it
kind
would
of...
be like, if we were going back now, we would go to Egypt, you know, and check out the... Or maybe even Rome, you know, if we were going back to the past.
Yeah, or...
You want to check out the central locations, yes.
Or the British Empire, depending on, like, which time period you're in. But you're not going to... You know, you're not going to... If you want to land in the early 21st century, you're not going to go to Estonia, right? I'm sorry, Estonia.
Yeah.
I think you're pretty cool, but, you know.
Yeah. But this is where it's happening. Like, I mean, everything's happening here.
Their whole e-government stuff, really cool, but, like... Not really that interesting to future humans, I would think. you would go to the US, you would go to China, you would go to Russia, right? Like, those are the places where you can actually, like... I mean, there's always a thing where, like, oh, yeah, maybe you do actually go back and, you know, save this random duke from some guy from Sarajevo, right? Like, there are these obscure things where, like, it maybe doesn't seem that big. But, you know, so I can kind of see,
but it
like,
saves the future, yeah.
The ripple effect kind of argument where, like, you do something that's fairly innocuous, but... If you want to change like the big things, you would go to the countries that are the biggest players, geopolitically speaking. And it does help a little bit explain why they keep it hidden, or how they keep it hidden. But all of
if you think
leaks, if you will, like all the people that do end up coming out are always talking about aliens and how they find like non-human remains and stuff. And it's like, also, oh God, there was this guy who testified in Congress, I think, and he was like, oh yeah, no, I've heard there are craft and there are non-human beings there. It's like, he has heard from someone that supposedly saw it first person. So now this is already second-hand account. And then I think it's somewhere in Mexico they were recently showing around some mummies that were apparently already disproven like 5 years ago. They were made out of human remains and like a lamb.
Oh yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
Like a llama skull. And it's like,
yeah, it was the same. Great. Same mummies, yeah.
Like, you're showing around mummies that were disproven 5 years ago? And you think people are going to buy them now? Like, huh?
Apparently that guy is a traveling con man, but how he pulled it off in front of the entire world twice is pretty amazing, though, if you think about it.
I mean, hey,
you go to a completely different country and do this all over again and people buy it again, like that's pretty amazing.
I mean I can't respect that, but like, obviously it doesn't prove anything about aliens.
Yeah, exactly. But if you think about it, the futuristic thing makes sense because of the image of the grays that we have could actually be a human evolution into the future, because the more safer and safer we make our environment, the more frail our bodies will become. And especially if you're not working anymore, you're going to get smaller and smaller. And if your intellect is constantly growing, your brain is going to get bigger and bigger. Your cranium has to get bigger for that. So I wonder if the image of the grays that has always been around is just basically science fiction fathoming what it would look like for an evolved human to look like, because they always assume that the aliens are much more intelligent than we are now. So they're like, they must look like that. Or, you know, you could be channeling like what we're going to look like in the future.
I mean, I think this could also just be like, oh, simple character designs, right? Like, you often have cartoon characters with, like, overly large heads because the head is, like, the emotive part. There are a lot of reasons for why you could make them that way. It could also be, as you said, right, like, reasonable speculation. Also, some of the grays aren't gray, they're green, and they have antennae, right? So, it's not that consistent, even. But,
well, they have to account for their telepathic communication. So, you have to have antenna, you know?
Obviously. No, but I mean, I just see the argument of like, oh yeah, the grays could, like, reasonably evolved humans could be like the grays. I mean, the eyes are a little weird because I think oftentimes they're like black eyes or something, which would take in a lot of light. So the argument is like, is their planet darker? Does Earth get darker, right? Like, but I mean, broadly speaking, a lot of the traits, yes, right? Like, also they're oftentimes not of hair, which makes sense because if you look at us versus our ancestors, right, we got less hairy over time. Yeah. So,
oh yeah, absolutely.
Some of these adaptations would make sense. I'm sure there you could find scientists that could explain to you why, like, some details about the grays they are commonly used are actually like kind of stupid. But a lot of like the very obvious things do seem very reasonable. But again, right? If they look like that, then why have we never seen a living one? Right? Like, why? Like, I mean, I guess central is hard, but like. Still seems odd.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you know of any more ponderings that people are attributing to what the alien beings are that we've been hearing so much about?
I mean, most of what I hear is just like the vague aliens thing, which I guess could more broadly encompass a lot of those things, right? Because they would all be alien to us in a sense. I mean, I guess the one thing that you do sometimes here is like the genetic experimentation thing where like, they're like, yeah, no, the UFOs are Russian spycraft, but also they have like genetically engineered beings that operate them. I think it's a bit more fringe, certainly if you do say they are of like a human origin, but like, you do sometimes hear about the idea of like genetic engineering. I think it's more of a 90s thing to some degree as well, but of like genetic engineering, like creating these sort of like not quite human beings.
Yeah. Bio soldier androids.
Although some versions of those also are just like alien DNA mixed with human, which is like, oh yeah, aliens are real, but also these are not aliens, these are hybrids, which like that's unnecessarily complicated. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean some of those maybe like old genetically modified humans, but again, right, like if there would be so many people working on making that happen that probably you would have heard about it.
You would think. Yeah, you would think. For a future podcast topic, because that's all I have for this one right now. But I was thinking, if you look into the CIA experiment of the Ra material, you know, the god of ancient Egypt. So in the, I want to say it was in the 80s. I'd have to look back at the dates, though, to make sure. They would have this lady channel a entity, an interdimensional entity that happened to come through and announce themselves as Ra, who was the god of ancient Egypt. And it is very fascinating. And it goes into how the pyramids were built and so many other things that we don't even have time to get into all of it right now. But that would be an interesting future podcast topic, too. And it made me think of it talking about interdimensional beings. We definitely should look into that one.
I mean, I will point out that we don't actually know how the name would have actually been pronounced. We don't. I mean, some versions say Ra, some say Re. Right, so there are like,
yeah,
there's a lot of, oftentimes these sort of things are awfully convenient. The most popular current pronunciation is also the one that happens, could be, right? But
yeah.
But I don't know anything about this really, so I can't really speak to it too much.
Yeah, definitely. After you look into it, we should talk about it. It's fascinating. It goes into the battle of like the Christian God and Ra versus Yahweh and Yah. I guess it would be Ra versus Yah, you know, but very fascinating. Anyway, that'll be for the future.
I will say the fact that the Christian God is in this makes this sound a lot more American.
It's just like, oh, it happened in America. Yes,
yeah, but
yes.
Like the Christian God and Ra, the one Egyptian God that most Americans would know. It's like, oh, right. Like
it makes you wonder. Yeah.
This sounds like the most American like version of the sort of conspiracy theory that I've heard about. I mean, obviously, a lot of these are American in general, but it does sound almost uniquely American.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I love looking into like channeling. So like Edgar Casey, you know, the sleep psychic and all this. Even Aleister Crowley's writings, you know, is fascinating to me.
He was also big into the Egyptian stuff, I believe. Thelema, I think, is also in
large part
based on that. But also on
tried to
Jewish mysticism, Ra. Kabbalah. I have looked into Thelema a little bit. I find it interesting. It's not that I would believe any of it, but it's just kind of interesting, right? Like, that's, I think, also worth mentioning about like all the various versions of like the alien stuff. It's like, I don't believe any of it, but it sure is interesting.
Yeah. Well, excuse me, I'm agnostic with everything, so I'm not going to say I believe it or disbelieve it. Like, I mean, it's possible, maybe.
I'm always a big fan of the idea of, like, you know, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence, right? So,
true.
And of course, certain things that we take for granted these days used to be considered extraordinary. So, but I mean, we did also find, Einstein's theory of gravity, right? There are things where, like, that seemed kind of wild, but they found the evidence, right? And so now we believe it because it seems to be the most consistent thing. And aliens walking on Earth? Not so much.
Yeah, well, and there's also like tulpas and things like that where if enough people believe it, it somehow manifests into reality.
I also collective unconscious type stuff, but again, right? Like, absolutely no evidence.
In the raw material, they actually talk about that's how the pyramids were built. And spoiler alert for that one. That it's the collective consciousness actually making the stones move themselves.
Ah, I see.
Faith can move mountains.
I feel like the pyramids is one of those where people are maybe a little too... it's like, oh, like they were like, oh, it would take like years to cut one of those stones. It's like, well, yeah, if you work on it alone.
Yeah, exactly.
Imagine you have an entire civilization with a big slave class that has a lot of time to build these. And it's like, oh, all of a sudden, if you work in parallel... So this doesn't seem quite crazy.
And the mathematics were phenomenal, though. And how they were able to line them up astronomically, if that's even a word, astronomically.
I was wondering about that because, like, did the Egyptians actually, like, do we have any evidence that they actually believe in that sort of stuff? Or is a lot of that just, or at least some of that just coincidence, right? Because it turns out there are a lot of stars in the sky, right? And you're going to hit one of them. It's one of those things where people also talk about, like, the whole like ley lines, if you draw them and there's like multiple ancient sites that line up with them, it's like,
yes, across the, yeah,
yes. And then I saw someone do that where they were like doing with the supermarket chain instead, and it turns out it works just as well, because
really,
if you have enough things that could be of interest, it's like, oh, some of those are bound to be at intersections of the ley lines, right? So
yeah, yeah. I want to see that video.
I think it was just, I think it was just a side by side picture, but yeah.
Oh, okay. That's funny.
I wouldn't also know. I wouldn't know how to find it because I don't remember the specifics. But yeah, a lot of that stuff is just like, oh yeah, if you're looking for a pattern, you'll find it.
Yeah, yeah, of course. It's like pareidolia. If you're looking for it, you'll see it.
But let's move on to our facts of the week. These ones are not quite as speculative. They're things that actually happened.
Yeah.
Or are, or whatever. What is your fact of the week?
We're hoping someone didn't lie to us here. Oh, man, did I get... Oh, yeah. Hold on. Let me retrieve it because I went away from it. All right. In April of 2013, someone hacked the Associated Press's Twitter account and tweeted that two bombs had exploded at the White House. The stock market crashed within seconds, only to recover the same day as the tweets were discovered to be a hoax. I did not remember this happening for some reason, but I would have thought it would have been big news at the time.
I think there was a similar thing this year or last year where there was like a photoshopped image of, I don't remember, it was like the White House, the Pentagon, like one of those like halls of Congress, I don't remember, like some important building like being on fire or something. And it was, I think it was AI generated because that was a big thing at the time, but like you might as well have just photoshopped it, but like someone posted it and apparently that gained some traction and people started believing it. And I think it also had like a small dip in the stock market, not maybe not as big as that one, but
yeah.
And in fact, and also when Twitter changed the blue checkmark thing and all of a sudden everyone could buy them, there were some brands who also like really had their stock tanked because some fake tweets made by someone who like took a handle that was similar to the company, posted something.
Mm-hmm.
I think I think the biggest one was insulin is now free or something like that from like one of the biggest pharma companies, and like their stock dipped hard for a moment there. And they were like, oh yeah, yeah. We're making insulin free. It's like stock goes down.
And that, my friend, is why we can't get single payer healthcare in a capitalist society.
Capitalism has its problems, and the only solution is regulation. Well, or not doing capitalism anymore, but that would be much more disruptive.
Oh yeah, there'll be a riot.
Also, collective bargaining. That's also support the unions.
Yeah.
My fact of the week does also relate to the United States, but in maybe a less serious manner. So football. That is American football.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of a big sport over there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And it turns out the United States national team has lost one football game.
Mm.
Just one. Against Germany. And you don't need to know anything else about that. We beat you. Okay, so
what was the record before that?
Okay, so the Germany in 2017 at the World Games, Germany beat the United States 14-13. And again, otherwise the United States is undefeated. Now, the caveat here is not that it was a one-point game, although that is of course worth noting. It is that in 2015, there was a bit of a leadership split in the International Federation of American Football, where through some shenanigans that honestly I don't fully understand and that is not very clearly explained here, there was some disagreement about who was actually in charge, and then there was one IFAF headquartered in Paris and one in New York that both claimed to be like the legitimate one, and it was the Paris one that organized the football competition for the World Games 2017. Now, some countries did not submit player lists to them for like their doping checks because I guess those countries didn't recognize them as the governing body or something. And one of those countries was the United States. And so the United States, the organization handles the, does it say here? USA Football, yeah. was removed as the official representative of the US team, and the United States Federation of American Football was inserted instead. Now, they were like, okay, we got this, right? We're getting players and stuff, and then you know, you're getting full funding for your trip, everything's fine. And then a couple days before the competition, they were like, oh yeah, actually, we can't pay you. And so they ended up just, so the World Games 2017, they were in Wrocław in Poland, and they just had to get any Americans, basically, that were in the general vicinity, that were willing to travel on their own dime to play for their team.
Yeah.
And they still ended up making third place. So they lost to Germany in the semifinals, and then in the third place match against Poland, they won. So I think it was also only like four or five countries playing there. Let's see. American football of the 2017 World Games Men's Tournament. Five countries? Wait, what? No, that's four. Oh, Japan withdrew. Okay, so there were only four countries in it to begin with. But yeah, Germany beat the US, France beat Poland, and then Germany lost to France. So I guess France also technically routed the US. But the US then beat Poland. So they actually won one of their two matches, despite not having a proper roster and just whomever.
So, yeah. Oh, yeah.
The whole point of, like, the U.S. national team lost, like, technically true.
Yeah.
But also, there are, like, a bunch of asterisks there. But yes, Germany is the only country to have beat the United States in an international football competition, as in, like, a national teams against national teams.
Yeah. Yeah, you would think we it's much like with the basketball team, the dream team of, like, 92. You know what? There's an interesting story about that, too, because, of course, America invented the sport, so we're going to be the best at it. We have the major league teams here. This is the epicenter of certain sports, so we should dominate the entire world in these sports. Mm-hmm. The dream team of 1992, it was like Jordan and Charles Barkley and Larry Bird, like the greatest names who ever played basketball were on this team. And they dominated, like, through the Olympics. They killed everyone, which I never even understood why professional players were allowed to play in basketball in the Olympics, but not, like, other sports like baseball and whatnot.
Yeah, I think the Olympics are supposed to be for amateurs, but I think that's not really enforced ever.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so they... Go ahead.
Having all of these huge names on the team, at first, they were not able to cooperate well together because these are all superstars, you know, and they all want to be the star. And they got beat by the practice team that they brought in, amateurs, I believe. I don't even think they were pro players. But yeah, their first practice, they were defeated by an amateur team, even though they went on to dominate every other country in the Olympics.
So, ordinarily, the U.S. national team, I don't know exactly, I mean, again, players have already in Europe, so probably applies you to, but normally they don't use any NFL players, and they also want every college level to be represented. So they're not active college players, because that would be a whole problem, I think, with, like, eligibility and whatnot, because of their rules.
Yeah.
But former college players from every level, that is, from FBS, FCS, D2, D3, NAIA, or NAIA, I don't know how you say it, the other league besides NCAA. So, like, all across. And, well, NAIA had, like, one team, I think, 1 year, one player 1 year. So it's not like they're, like, very represented. But I think the other levels were all somewhat evenly split as well. So you had between FBS, FCS, D2, and D3. So they're not even, like, the best players that barely did make the NFL. It's not that good of a team in terms of actual, like, player quality as compared to, like, professional American teams, for example. But internationally speaking, football, very much a growing sport in a lot of places in Europe, for example, but by no means as big as in the US.
Also, oh, yeah, of course not.
Also, there hasn't been any international competition for, like, well, at least for, like, men's 11-on-11 tackle football. I don't know, but I think other levels, like juniors, have happened, but the last world championship was in 2015, and the World Games were 2017, the last time. So I think 2022 had flag football in the World Games, but they didn't have tackle football, so there also haven't been that many opportunities since then, and I think the US also hasn't played the first two World Championships, so there have only been like three that they've been in. So it's also like a bit of a limited set of competitions. And the World Championship keeps not happening because I think in 2015 it was supposed to be hosted in Sweden, but then Sweden withdrew, and they end up playing in the US with only like half of the countries that were initially meant to be in there, because most of them didn't want to play. And then in 2019, so it's supposed to be every 4 years, a bunch of teams withdrew again, and the IFAF was like, okay, we're just not doing this, we're going to delay this to, I think, 2021, 2023, I don't remember exactly. And then, you know, COVID happened, and they were like, actually, this is looking a bit dicey, and so they moved it to 2025, which is supposed to be when the next world, the next American Football World Championship is supposed to be held, 10 years after the previous one.
Yeah.
And we'll see if it happens at all.
Yeah. It'd be nice. It is crazy, though, that what team they could be able to put together from players that, like a player that is going to the NFL is not going to want to play in it, of course. It's much like the XFL or the USFL. They're not going to want to go there if they're going to the NFL. And a lot of times they only go there to get back to the NFL. But I was thinking maybe they should put together like an all-star team from USFL and the XFL and the Canadian League and the Germany League and have this big tournament. But I guess that's kind of what's going on in a way.
I mean, international competition is sort of like an all-star team. And the European championships have been happening pretty regularly. So it is working. The problem, I think, with international competition is also that right, like the Soccer World Cup works because like basically every country under the sun plays soccer. And American football is basically, it's like Canada, which is Canadian football, which is slightly different, but close enough. US, Mexico, Japan, and then like Europe. And Europe has a lot of countries, right? So that kind of, but that's pretty much it. And so you have these four non-European countries, and honestly, at this point, quite a few European ones as well, but like very competitive. You have Germany, you have France, you have Italy, and then that's probably about it. Austria, maybe. Austria's very good in terms of actual clubs, so I'm assuming that they might be good on a national level as well. But yeah.
Definitely. I think there are some like minor leagues going on in like Australia and New Zealand and whatnot, but of course they love the rugby there, so which I think you could easily teach a rugby player to play American football.
Yes, they play rugby there, and well, cricket and a bunch of other sports, and Aussie rules football, which has pretty much nothing to do with American football.
Exactly.
But is suspiciously similar to Gaelic football. The more you know. Bonus fact, by the way. Although we should probably move on from the facts, but there is a format known as International Rules Football, which is a combination of Gaelic football and Aussie Rules Football, because those games are actually somewhat similar. And so it's actually like an Irish team and the Australian team that regularly, like as a sort of national team, that do somewhat regularly play against each other.
Wow.
So there's a fun
fact. I imagine, because a lot of Australians are Irish in heritage. So. I mean,
also, Gaelic rules is genuinely similar to Aussie rules. The main thing is they have smaller teams and the stadium looks just like a soccer pitch rather than like those weird like rounded ends. Like the Aussie rules stadiums are wild and they're pretty big. And so obviously, if you're playing in a country where the main sport is soccer, you're going to adapt your game to play in a soccer stadium.
Yeah, exactly.
Also, by the way, soccer pitch and football field, pretty much the same size. Didn't know that for the longest time, but I've been watching the ELF a bit recently, and they obviously play American football also in stadiums that also play soccer, and so sometimes you still see the remnants of the soccer lines, and you can really well see like the size of a soccer field versus a football field, because they basically have lines for both.
Yeah, I believe the Rams and the Chargers were sharing a soccer stadium when they first moved back to LA. I believe they both share the same stadium, but Yeah, they were. They were in a soccer stadium in the beginning before they had their new stadium built.
I mean, yeah, I know LA also has an MLS team, but I don't really know that much about American soccer or any soccer that much.
I don't even know that much about American soccer. I know Atlanta won the championship.
I was going to say, I think Atlanta's doing like really well.
2021, maybe? They won the... I think it might have been 2020, actually. Whenever it was. Was it?
I don't know. I very briefly looked at Major League Soccer a couple days ago on Wikipedia, because I don't know why. But I'm not really into soccer, so it was just like, hey, let's, you know, just a fun, like, oh yeah, where are their teams anyways, and, you know, like, competition stuff like that.
Yeah.
But talking about sports that is played all around the world. Not a sport, but all around the world. We have languages. And today, we're once again going to guess where languages are from. I'm assuming we're going to go hard, because we're actually, I think, fairly good at this. And let's start the game. This is also one where it's important that you can actually hear what they're saying. I hope this works. So, is it Hungarian, Mongolian, or Ainu? Ainu, I don't know.
I have an idea. I don't know what Ainu is. That sounds like it's Polynesian or something.
It does actually, now that you say it.
Yeah. But I'm guessing Hungarian, because it kind of has that almost like a Russian like swing to the words, that that sound.
Yeah, I was thinking that too. It sounded almost weirdly, I want to say, like a mix between Russian and Swedish, which I know there's no particular base for it. So Hungarian, of course, for the uninitiated, is a Finno-Ugric language, so it's not particularly related to Russian at all. The most closely related languages would be Finnish and Estonian, but I could see that being Hungarian. It was Mongolian.
No, wow. Don't know that I've ever actually heard a Mongolian speak, so maybe they... Well, I mean, if you think about it, the proximity there is kind of would make sense that they would almost share a dialect with Russia, in a sense.
I don't know if it's actually like Russian influences necessarily. I would assume that Mongolia is more Chinese influences, if anything, because Inner Mongolia, which is where actually most Mongolians live, is part of China. But they do obviously border both countries, so unclear.
But it didn't have like the ting, ting, ying, zings, like I don't want to sound racist saying it, but you know, like the,
it didn't
the
sound very sound Chinese.
The Chinese. Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Well, we have Kannada, which I now know is actually a language from India, Nepali, and Greek. I mean, I guess I don't have to explain where those come from.
So, Tallana anta select madidre. Idu yava vishayad mele anta kelabada? Jaasti maatadalla alli anta. Janara nenpalu uliyalla. So, andre manushyara manasnalli aguva tumulugalu, adaralli aguvanta dvandugalu. So, hege namma bhavanegalu.
Kind of sounds like a Latin language to me.
I thought it had a little bit of that, like, it sounded like a little bit like it could be something from in or around India, just from what it sounded to me like. I mean, I didn't pick out any words or anything, so it's just like the sound, and it sounded slightly Indian to me, but the problem is Nepal is not that far from India either. So we have one language spoken in India, and one that is spoken in a neighbor of India, and then Greek, which I feel like it isn't, but also I couldn't say for certain.
Yeah. I don't know. This is a tough one, man.
Also, by the way,
I don't know.
In case I haven't said this to you before, I was assuming that Kannada was like some sort of indigenous language in Canada, right? Like the country might be named after some tribe that lived there or something. But then I randomly came across a meme at one point where it was like the down, but I put all the swords on the table. And it was just like a bunch of languages of India, and I was like, Kannada? It's like, okay. And I always figured that was in a very different part of the world.
Yeah, of course, that was my first thought. Yeah. like Africonics or for Africa or something. But yeah, well, you would think, oh, that must be a Canadian.
Maybe Afrikaans is derived from Dutch and it's spoken in South Africa.
Yeah, it's Afrikaans. What did I say? Afrikonics. Yeah, but yeah, you know what I'm talking about.
Yes. That's obviously one of those where it's technically a colonizer language that was just adapted by the locals, basically. So I guess when the Dutch started realizing that it sounds different from how they speak it, they're like, oh, this is like the African version of the language, right? Mm-hmm. And so then that Afrikaans then became the limit language.
Yeah, yeah. But you're going to have to guess on this one because I have no clue.
Well, I'm leaning between these two, and I don't know what Nepali sounds like, but it's closer to China than this one, so I'm going to go with the first one.
Ah, good job.
I was had some degree of certainty that it wasn't Greek, but besides that...
it did not sound Asian to me.
Khmer, I don't know how to say that. Maltese or Spanish? I think Khmer is somewhere in Africa.
That is not Spanish, I can tell you that.
Yeah, I was fairly certain that as well.
Khmer,
I was thinking it might be, but... Maltese. Yeah, I know a little bit about Asian. Maltese. Maltese is spoken in Malta, obviously. It's a Semitic language, so it's closely related to Arabic. But it has a lot of loanwords from Spanish because obviously Malta is like right by Spain. So
mm-hmm.
I think it also has Italian loanwords. So I would think that it's probably not Maltese, but I can't know for certain.
I'm saying Khmer because my first thought was like a Southeast Asian, like Vietnamese or something like that. So. I would pick Khmer if it was me.
Yeah, that's what I was saying, right? Because I don't think it's Maltese. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's Spanish. So,
yeah.
Norwegian, Minangkabau, or Filipino, which I believe means Tagalog, which is the language of the Philippines.
Mm-hmm.
Det sier talsperson for naboene på Sørbrotten ved Utøya, Maria Holtane Berge. I dag kom det frem at staten har foreslått å skrote det planlagte minnestedet etter 22. juli-terroren på Sørbrotten ved Utøya.
I'm guessing Norwegian.
It's always surprising how little I understand. I know it's a completely different language from German, but it's like related to German, right? So it always feels like I should understand more than I do.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, like the whole like U thing, like that felt very like Nordic. It's not that different from the German U, I guess, or French U for that matter. But it like the way they have like the U and U, and like it kind of always feels Nordic whenever you hear one of those.
Yeah, and it seems like there always has to be a female doing the Nordic languages.
I mean, in a way, that's less surprising, right? Because those are, I think, some of the most progressive countries in terms of gender equity. That doesn't necessarily mean that it should be just women, but obviously that makes it more likely it would be women than in the country where maybe women don't have a lot to say.
So in that sense.
I mean, I think, wasn't there also like at one point that like two or three of the Nordic countries had female prime ministers at the same time? And stuff like that. So like, it seems to me that those are a lot more equal than even other Western countries to some degree.
Yeah. Considering even America hasn't done that yet, it hasn't had one. Female president.
I mean,
I don't think Canada has either, have they?
Well, they certainly haven't had a female president, but they did have a female head of state for the longest time.
Ah, gotcha. Yeah, I didn't think they had as far as.
But not a head of government, I think, but definitely a head of state because Queen Elizabeth II.
I wasn't even putting together what you were saying.
You said gotcha. I thought you were like, oh yeah. Right. No, because their head of state is the British monarch.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they're under British monarch rule.
Okay, so here the options are Albanian,
my bad. I didn't mean to cut you off, but I was thinking like Secretary of State, like the US has, and I'm like, Yeah, maybe I did hear something about that.
No. Head of state would be the president in the U.S., and head of government would be the Speaker of the House.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, God, but just Kevin McCarthy. Fuck that guy. But, no, when I said Speaker of the House, the very first thing I popped in my head was Nancy Pelosi. And, I mean, you know, she was not perfect, but, like, she was all right. But, like, dude, Kevin McCarthy is a mess.
I don't know, man. Nancy Pelosi is a very polarizing figure. Man. Like, I mean, so much so that there were death threats and people showed up to her house and beat her husband with a hammer.
Yeah,
I mean, it was brutal, man. People hated Nancy Pelosi.
Yeah, I think the Republicans hated her for other reasons than I think would be maybe more valid to hate her before, but yeah, no, she definitely was by no means beyond reproach. But I mean, Kevin McCarthy seems to mostly be thinking about hanging on to the job as Speaker in the first place and goes along with like all sorts of crazy Republican bullshit. Like, they launch an impeachment inquiry against Biden.
Yeah.
Not because they have any evidence that, I mean, I guess the inquiry essentially is to gather evidence, but they got nothing on him. But they thought it would look good politically, I guess. I don't know.
And it doesn't matter who is president now, there is going to be an impeachment inquiry against every single president going forward. I mean, I think there has been since Bill Clinton, and it will continue every single president.
I don't actually know if there has been one against Obama. I mean, obviously, Trump was twice impeached.
Oh, I'm pretty sure there was.
I don't know. But actually, you said Clinton, so that would also be another Bush
had there. One. Yeah.
Okay, but I don't know about impeachment inquiries, but impeachments we definitely only had. There have only been four, I believe, at home. Two of which were against Trump.
Yeah. Yeah. But anyway, we were playing a game here.
So yeah, Albanian, a language whose name I definitely cannot pronounce because that XH is a click sound. And a Vietnamese.
Yeah.
Duhet të ndroi bashkuar dhe I qetë pavarësisht çfarë po ndodh. Ndërkohë që ka urdhëruar mbylljen e kufive të Francës për të shmangur ndonjë largim të mundshëm të terroristëve. Holland shtoi se janë duke u kryer të gjitha operacionet e nevojshme në këtë situatë, ndërsa forcat e policisë janë në kërkim të atentatorëve në Paris. Tutje ai thotë.
Yep, my guess is Albanian.
Yep, because I was saying the same thing.
Also sounds European, very European.
Yeah. I'm assuming Albanian. Wait, Albania, I would assume that is Islamic language, but I don't actually know that. I don't know what language group Albania like belongs to. I mean, a little bit, but it also didn't really sound that Russian either. I mean, obviously, Russian not the only Slavic language, but it almost, I felt a little bit, not all of it, but some parts of how I pronounce things, sounded almost Austrian to me. I mean, obviously they speak German over there, but like just Bavarian, right? Like just the way they talk. But obviously, again, that's not necessarily that useful. Frisian, Macedonian, or Javanese? Do you want to know anything about this language, or do we just want to listen first?
I don't know. I don't know what is Javanese, and what is Frisian.
Well. Those languages are spoken in Java and Frisia. So Java is an Indonesian island.
Okay.
And Frisia is a region. Well, actually, it's a region in Germany and the Netherlands. So there is North Frisia, West Frisia, and East Frisia, I believe. Was that South Frisia? No, I think it's South Frisia. I don't think there's an East Frisia, which are like variously. I think one of those is actually like a state in the Netherlands. The German one is more like an informal region, but the Germanic. So Frisian is a Germanic language. It's West Germanic, it's closely related to German and Dutch. Macedonian and Slavic, it's spoken in, well, I guess in North Macedonia, because Macedonia is a region of Greece, which is the whole reason why I can't call myself Macedonia. And Javanese is obviously spoken on the island of Java.
They border with Bulgaria, so I'm assuming it will be something similar. To Bulgarian.
Yeah, South Slavic, I believe, is a language group.
Gatek no opo sing dadi pangandikane roh suci marang pasamuan-pasamuan sing sopo unggul bakal tak paringi mangan mana sengkeran sarto bakal tak paringi watu putih. Ing watu mau ku ukir jeneng anyar sing ora dingerteni.
Definitely sounds Southeast Asian, so I'm going with Java.
I mean, the interesting thing to me is that it doesn't sound very Indonesian, but I mean, like, as in, like, Bahasa Indonesia, the actual, like, main Indonesian language. But, mm-hmm. I mean, obviously, just, yeah, the pronunciation, like, the ng's and the way he pronounces the r's, like, it's all very, like, that. Okay, now we have four options.
Yeah, absolutely.
Vietnamese, wow. Tigrinya, Tamil, and Tongan.
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming you know where all of this is spoken.
not Tamil right offhand.
Tamil is spoken in India, I believe.
Is it India? Okay. All right. Good. Let's go.
So you do know where Tigrinya is spoken? Because I'm a little bit surprised by that, but...
maybe I don't. Where is it?
It's in the Tigris region of Ethiopia and Eritrea. I believe it is spoken a little bit in Eritrea as well. But it's
Well, I was. That's what I was thinking. Is Tigris, but
yeah, exactly. Yeah. Tigris is the river.
Eho ko hene ke ngā ue kwhai ki ono whenga ke mahino I heka ai whetō aki I he ea, pe ko e whediru aki ko ia. I got it.
O kilo he toko lahi. What do you got?
This is Polynesian, that's Tongan.
Wow, yeah. See, the thing is, I was still considering Vietnamese.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I don't know my Polynesia from my Asia, like... I mean, it's really not that far geographically. Lao, Romanian,
we're getting...
Punjabi, and Frisian again.
Oh,
what were you gonna say?
Mm. I was thinking we're getting Southeast Asia on every one of them.
Laos.
But
yeah.
Is it
Southeast Asia?
Yes. Yeah, so next to the Vietnam, right?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. It's not that far south, is it?
I'm actually looking it up right now. Let's see where the location.
Because Southeast Asia, I'm thinking more here. Like the Philippines, unless, you know, China, Vietnam, Thailand, those sort of like that's more East Asia.
I mean, it's not the island, but it, you know, it's right there with Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam, Hanawai, Myanmar. Yeah, I mean, that's...
Did you just say Hanawai? Because I'm pretty sure, first of all, you meant Hanoi, and that's also the capital of Vietnam, or
Hanoi.
Is it not?
Yeah, Hanoi. Yeah.
Because I think it's just...
But yeah, it says Laos is a Southeast Asian country.
Kind of, yeah. To be frank, now that I think about it, I don't know exactly where the border between East Asia and Southeast Asia would be drawn. I mean, it's obviously an informal term anyways, but... So yeah, let's play this.
Yeah.
Notăm surprinderea multor analiști la aflarea datei alegerilor federale, având în vedere că aceasta venea la scurt timp după ce primul ministru anunțase măsuri drastice de economisire la buget și mai ales semnarea împreună cu președintele Republicii Nauru, baron Waka, a unui acord de procesare și relocare în Nauru, denotat că ulterior anunțului comun, un purtător de cuvânt al președintelui Waka a declarat la că niciunul dintre acei azilanți...
Oh, the club is already over.
I'm a Romanian friend. So I'm guessing Romanian.
I was thinking it sounded like it could be Romanian, right? It had like a little bit of the Slavic influence, but it's not a Slavic language, it's a Romance language, but it has Slavic influences. I mean, the word for yes is da.
Yeah.
Right? You can kind of see that. Uh-huh. The one thing that made me a little bit uncertain is why was he talking about Nauru? I mean, I'm sure he can have reasons for that, but it's...
Could just be reading the news.
I mean, that's the problem, right? Sometimes when they mention a country, it's like, oh, like this is relevant to them. And sometimes it's just like, it just happened to be talked about.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think we'll go Romanian. I'm not going to go like, oh, he mentioned another country that... Yeah.
Yeah.
But Bajinese? Bujinese? I've never heard of them. Ukrainian, ooh, Hindi, or Bulgarian. Well, at least those three are ones that I know where they're spoken. But then again, ooh, do you know the difference, like, just sound-wise or language-wise, I guess, between Ukrainian and Bulgarian? Because there's a... I'm assuming Bulgarian is South Slavic, and Ukrainian is, what is it, East Slavic? But whatever, whatever.
I don't think just hearing them, I could tell the difference now.
Well, that's going to be rough, then, if it's one of them.
Papalabang
ripasalana apunenges jajina rupatawi sinina rupataur jajiang irlinoi pada napunai man memini riasang apunangan.
The problem is I don't know what the one on the left is, right? The Bajanese one.
Yeah, that's. I'm looking up the location,
but it
could be Hindi. Oh, I mean, it's Australian. Like
I was thinking it sounded like it could be Hindi.
open habitats, primary in the scrublands, open woodlands, and grasslands of Australia. So that's an Aboriginal, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's got to be Hindi, right?
Oh, no, never mind.
Oh, it is that. Oh.
That's the problem, wow. Right? Because it's like, what do Aboriginals sound like when they talk? I don't know.
You think of like the clicking and stuff a lot like some of the African languages, but...
I guess. I
mean, yep, Duncan.
Clicks are actually surprisingly common, not in terms of like everywhere, but there are actually languages all over the place that have them. So I think some of the indigenous North American languages also actually have them, which I mean, I guess makes sense. No, actually, does not necessarily. But I think there were some that have them. But yeah, no. I was like, okay, we don't have to distinguish between Ukrainian and Bulgarian. That's great. And then it's like, yeah, but
yeah,
we still have to distinguish. I saw Ukrainian, I saw B, and I was like, did most of us not change? Ukrainian and Hindi are both still there. But now it's Burmese and Latin.
See? More Southeast Asia.
For a brief moment there, I was like, where did the Roman Empire, how far did the Roman Empire go? But you're talking about Myanmar, yeah.
yeah.
तो मैं सामग्री दोहराए देती हूँ हम आज बना रहे हैं एंट्री खुम यानी आप जान चार लोग करीब खा सकेंगे और इसको बनाने में 25 से 30 मिनट लगेंगे तो आपको लेने हैं 12 बड़े और
come to think of it this sounds more Hindi than the previous one.
yeah
I just realized the thing that definitely wasn't Hindi about the previous one was the R's right I pointed them out before in another one where like the almost like slightly rolled R's right. Yeah, it's not quite rolled, but it's like the I don't quite know how they do it, but and
but of course the rolling is Latin also.
I mean yes, but in this one it's more like the feel. I was it rounder? I don't know. That's just like but the right, like it's almost like the American R, but like further up front in the mouth, I think. But like that sounds very much like an Indian accent, right? Like they don't really have like clearly enunciated R's.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I'd be going with Hindi also.
Yep. Macedonian again, Lao again, Uzbek and Estonian.
Yeah.
Assalomu alaykum. Efirda 9-noyabr dushanba dasturi. Studiyada men Odil Ruzaliyev. Eshitirishimiz Hotbird sun'iy yo'ldoshi orqali efirga uzatilyapti. Vaqti bilan 22:00 da takror tinglashingiz mumkin. Kech soat 11 da Almaz FM radiosida. Afg'onistonda esa 19:30 da Samangon shahrida. Shaharvand FM 87.8 to'lqinida ham havo mavjlaridamiz.
I'm going with Uzbekistan.
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't know much about Laos, but Uzbek is...
Hey, he mentioned some Muslim things in there.
Yeah, he says Assalamu Alaikum, which is Arabic for hello, but is also used by Muslims around the world. And...
Yeah,
well, that hello is probably like good day or something. I don't know the exact but translation, but which made me think Muslim as well. And Uzbekistan, obviously, I mean, Stan, right? Like that alone should give you a good idea, right? But it's south of Russia, somewhere in like the... Central Asia, I believe they call it. In that sort of former Soviet, but...
Bleeding over into the Middle East.
Yeah. I mean, the South Asia, Central Asia, and the Middle East, as well as North Africa to a degree, they all kind of sort of are on a continuum, I feel like.
Yeah. Because, I mean, and actually, the song Rock the Casbah brought that up in one of our episodes recently.
Oh, yeah, The Clash.
Yeah.
No, because I was thinking, right, like Pakistan, right? Like that's South Asia. That's the Indian subcontinent. And then, you know, you have your Uzbekistan and then Afghanistan, right? And that's almost the Middle East. I mean, it's not quite in there. Like that's more, but you know, those are still very much already Arabs. And then the Middle East, you know, you have your UAEs and your Syrias and like those are Arabs. And then you get over to Egypt and those are still Arabs. And it's like, it's all like the South Asians and the Turks and the Arabs and the Kurds. And those are, I feel like those exist on a continuum to some degree.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like it's hard to draw like hard dividing lines. Well, I mean,
yeah.
We've had Bajanese already, so we know what that one's like. Achenese. Maltese and Spanish.
Yeah, I need to look up that. Is it
like ace and then H and then knees. Normally don't look things up in this game, but hey.
Oh, my bad.
No, I mean,
I'm not looking up the language itself. I'm just looking up the location.
It's one of those things where, like, if I had remembered it, I might have looked it up after game at some point to remember where it is, but I usually don't. So it's actually kind of cool to learn where those languages are from, even if we don't end up hearing it, maybe.
It is also Southeast Asia. It is one of the Sumatra Islands. And it says one of the main ethnic groups of the islands of Sumatra and Indonesia, so.
Huh.
I guess it's not technically a country or whatever, yeah, but it's a type of person.
It's that thing, right, where it's like, if you're in, like, India, Indonesia, right, like, somewhere around that area, I mean, I think China has a ton of groups as well, but also China's a big country, but, like, where you have, like, hundreds of languages that are spoken in various parts.
Yeah, exactly. With slight variations.
Well, yeah, but sometimes also like entirely different ones, like almost next to each other, which is also wild. I mean, often they are related, but not always.
L-ekonomija natat prominenza fl-ewwel ġimgħa tal-kampanja elettorali b'kull kamp politiku jgħid li huwa l-aħjar sabiex jimmaniġġja l-ekonomija. Deċiżjoni tal-Bank ta' Riserva sabiex tnaqqas ir-rati uffiċjali tal-imax bdiet mewġa ta' reazzjonijiet dwar se tfisser din id-deċiżjoni għall-ekonomija. Il-koalizzjoni tgħid li aktar toħ fir-rati tal-imax juri li l-ekonomija qed tiddeteriora. U din
That is actually Spanish. I almost thought it a bit weird. That's interesting, but okay, so one thing I hate is when they talk about these sort of like finances, right, and politics. Because half of the words are Latin. But it doesn't matter which language you speak, it's almost always the same words, right? Like, economy, right? It's like, fucking hell, I mean, actually, it's not in German, but in a lot of languages, those sort of words, right? Parlament, right? Those are almost universal.
Which makes them
very useless. Now, at the very end there, before I paused it, because I didn't want it to go on for too long, what was it? There was something like decline or like something that also was like a Latin word that is not as universal, which I noticed. I mean, I'm not saying it's Spanish, it literally isn't, but now I have a problem, right, where I don't know what Maltese sounds like exactly, but it does seem like there could be Spanish loans.
Well, that's what I was going to say. It sounds like Spanish to me, but it's a weird dialect. Like, it's almost like someone who speaks a different language who is speaking Spanish as a second language, but they have a weird dialect from a different language. But then again, there's the difference between, you know, South Americans and Mexicans and people actually from Spain.
There are plenty of words in there that don't have Latin roots. I like a lot of the smaller words as well. I don't think this is Spanish. But it could be a language that was heavily borrowed vocabulary from Spanish, like, for example, Maltese.
Yeah.
Which is why I'm feeling a little bit Maltese, but that's also still just an educated guess, right? But that's what I'm. Unless you have something else you prefer.
No, let's go for it.
Maltese.
You're right. Yep.
I wasn't sure about the pronunciation because that would have expected to sound a little bit more Arabic, because again, right, Semitic language, right, like Arabic, Hebrew, those sort of, but again, heavily influenced by Spanish. Urdu, Mongolian, Bajanese, again. Oh, this one should be easy. Forget it. English and Bulgarian.
All right, I gotta look up Urdu.
Urdu is also spoken in India.
Oh, okay.
I think it's actually closer to Hindi. I think Hindi and Urdu are pretty closely related.
При упражняването на своите права и свободи е подчинен само на такива ограничения, установени със закон, изключително с цел да се осигури необходимото признаване и зачитане правата и свободите на другите.
Are we thinking the same thing, Conrad?
Bulgarian? Yes.
Yeah. That sounded very Slavic.
Absolutely.
Haitian Creole, Frisian, Occitan, Luxembourgish, or Malay. Fuck!
Haitian Creole, that's of course going to be the French-influenced Haiti.
Yeah, it's a French-based Creole, but Occitan is a regional language, I want to say in France, that is also of Romance origin. I don't know if it's, it might be Spain. I think it's Catalan more on the Spanish side and Occitan more on the French side. So, like, I don't know if I can distinguish between Occitan and Haitian Creole. Meanwhile, Luxembourgish, closely related to German, it's basically a standardized version of the West Frankish dialect of German. But Frisian is also close-ish to German. So I'm not 100% sure if I can distinguish between those two either.
So we're hoping it's Malay, because that will be the easiest to differentiate.
Bahasa Malaysia. Yeah, let's go for that one.
Mm-hmm.
C'est faire un passe-temps cap de distinction fondée sur les statuts publics, administratifs et internationaux des pays ou territoires que la personne ne dépend juridiquement. Dans quel pays ou territoire sont indépendants, sous tutelle, non autonome ou soumise à qui non limitation de souveraineté que sien. Article 13. Tout individu a droit à la vie, à la liberté et à la sécurité de sa personne. Article 4. Degun sera pas tengut en esclavage ni en servitude. L'esclavage et le trafic d'esclaves sont prohibits dans toutes les formes.
I think it was a declaration of human rights again. I'm 100% sure. But it's definitely close to French.
Mm-hmm. Now, that's why I was thinking Haitian Creole, but it kind of had the European swing to the words. I don't even know a better word to say it. But.
One of the words ended in dot, which makes me think Spanish, right? Occitan, I think, is similar to Catalan in some ways, in which both of them have been described as being almost a little bit between French and Spanish. Both of which, of course, Romance languages, all of them, so they're all closely related anyways. So that is on the one hand, and on the other hand, I'll just say something racist, right? He sounded black to me, right? It sounded like he had like one of those accents that you sometimes get when you have like black people coming to France or something, and then they pick up French, and they still have like those accents, right? So
yeah,
now Haitians, black, but also very much not in Africa, so I don't really know what they like. Sound like.
But aren't they originally of African descent, though? Well, same thing with Jamaicans.
But then the question is, right, like, how has the way they speak changed over the last, like, what, like 150 years or something? So that is the problem, because just because someone has the same skin color doesn't mean they sound the same, because that's much more formed by where you live. So that's the...
Yeah. When I hear Jamaicans and Haitians talk, it's really hard to differentiate which one they are. I mean, you can after listening to them for a while, but they're very similar.
Well, but do you mean when they speak English? I'm assuming.
Yes, when they speak English.
Because when they speak their respective Creoles, they should sound very different, because Haitian Creole is French-based, and the Jamaican Creole, whose name escapes me at the moment, is English-based. So that should be distinguishable.
So needless to say, I'll go with whatever you think it is, because I don't know right offhand. I want to guess Haitian Creole, but
yeah, let's go with Haitian Creole. I genuinely can't say for any
certainty. Right?
Oh fuck, see.
Oh, you're right. I should have went with your first guess.
Yeah, but I had two different things that I picked up on in the speech that made me go into opposite directions. Now the problem always is, right? Is it a first language speaker, right? I don't know.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think we've been on for a while here, so we'll probably just move on straight to the second topic.
Yeah.
Which actually, I didn't need to change the view for at all, because we're doing this like this as well. So would you rather, now in a new design, because it's a different website.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if we've done this particular version before, but it's I mean, it works the same way as the other one. Every food you eat is too salty, or every drink you drink is too sweet. Which one would you rather?
Ooh. I think I'm going with the sweet.
I mean, either way,
it's going to be irritating after a while.
I mean, the question is, who defines what is too salty and too sweet, right? Is it like the general societal understanding of what is too salty and too sweet? Or is it our personal
Personalized opinion? Yeah.
Because yeah. I actually like salt.
I would hope it's the general, because I probably could take sweet more than the average person.
Because I'm personally, I would go salty, right? Two things. Mm. First of all, you eat like what? 2-3 times a day? I mean, sure, it's annoying if it's annoying for snacks, right? I guess chips would work, but like if you want to have like a chocolate chip cookie, it's salty, that's probably weird. But
yeah.
Like I drink a lot of water. And sweet water just does not sound pleasant.
Well, you don't drink like sodas or anything?
Rarely, not regularly.
Huh.
Coffee and water. Yeah. I like the big
sweet water.
The big, like, what is it? 73 ounces.
Yeah. Yeah, I usually buy like the 1 liters of smart water, the alkaline water or whatever during the day at work. But I'll also have like something. And then morning is coffee, and the evening is a soda, Cherry Coke Zero, whatnot.
Then, let's backtrack a second. Did you just say 1 liter? Since when do you use metric?
Oh, that's what they measure it in. I mean, I don't know. I don't even know what the ounces would be.
Are your drinks measured in liters?
Some of them are, yes. The soda's definitely... like, if you get this size, it's 20 ounces. But if you get the bigger size than this, it's a 2 liter.
Okay.
And you can also get 1 liters. Because they're rare these days. But
this is 2.2 liters and 73 ounces. It says both of them on it.
Mm-hmm.
It also spells... Wait, do the Brits spell liter the French way? Because this says litre. With like R-E instead of E-R.
This one doesn't even have... It has milliliters. That's 591 milliliters. But it also has 1.25 pints.
I mean, 591 milliliters is 0.591 liters, right? So... You don't need both, right? It's easy to convert. It's trivial.
True. Yeah.
So, I mean, we would...
But usually, they would.
I think... I mean, if it's like actually like exactly half a liter or something, we would put it with point as well. But I think if you had something like that,
yeah.
We would also put it in milliliters because no one will put 0.591 on there.
Yeah, exactly. I would think you could just round up and put it to 0.6 liters.
Legally in the EU, I believe you would not be allowed to do that if it is... actually 0.591. I don't think you can round.
Oh wow, there's no margin for error.
I'm not 100% sure. I know there's also something like an E behind it, like a stylized E, which that I think means that it's guaranteed that it's at least that much. I don't know what the general rule is, but yeah, no, usually if there's a thing on the drink, it's usually at least that much, right? And so if you end up having like I am assuming they put like 1 or 2% extra just to make sure that, you know, but I don't know. So I'm going to personally pick salty, but I don't think we're going to find agreement here, which is not the point anyways. It was 25-75 sweet. And I still didn't fix the scene so you can actually see the percentages. I also, a lot of the percentages do come out very clean. So I'm assuming that not a lot of people have used this particular website before. So a lot of the questions will probably only have like, if it's 45, if it's 25-75, it might well just have 4 or 8 answers. So.
Oh, yeah.
The sample size might be fairly small. Would you rather be able to drink anything but have a 50% chance of choking each time? Or only be able to drink water but only have a 1% chance of choking? Which is still higher than normal, I would say.
Yeah.
Actually, maybe 1%.
Yeah, because I don't know. Do you choke 1% of the time you eat or drink?
The problem is 100. How long does it take you to drink 100 times? I guess. I guess I do drink more often over a day than you really think about it. So it's probably like 12 times over a day. So probably not every like 2 weeks you choke, but it does happen.
Yeah, I guess you do more than you really think about it. Yeah. Well, I mean, do you die if you're only drinking water? I mean, you have to have some other sustenance.
I mean, both of those only specifically refer to drinking, so I'm assuming this doesn't preclude you from food.
Mm.
I'm assuming it's just like, okay, you can't drink soft drinks or coffee or anything like that. It's just, if it's liquid, it has to be water.
I'm taking the water then.
I would say so as well. I mean, I only drink coffee and water anyways. I would miss the coffee, but...
Yeah.
That was 2080. 80 for water.
Mm-hmm.
Would you rather lose Wi-Fi for a year, or would you rather have prices go up by 20% for you for a year? I'm assuming that's everything 20% up. I don't know for certain how it's intended.
For every year, I'll take the year without Wi-Fi before I... Yeah, because you get 10 years into that and you can't afford anything.
For 20% for a year. Not per year, for a year.
Oh, for a year. Oh, my bad. Well,
both of these are for 1 year. Either everything is 20% more expensive, man, or you don't have Wi-Fi.
See, I read per a year. That's tough, man. Does it go back down after a certain period of time?
I mean, I'm assuming everything is 20% more expensive for you. For the duration of a year afterwards, it goes back to whatever everyone else is paying.
Oh, okay. So, you probably... Well, I guess then it comes down to, do you pay 20% of your income for Wi-Fi? No, I don't.
Not of the income, of your expenses, I guess, but... here's the thing, right? I lose the Wi-Fi. Easy. I don't use Wi-Fi anyways. Yeah.
Use mobile? Or what do you use? Oh, Ethernet. You use, okay.
Like, Wi-Fi is wireless, right? So,
yeah.
If you wire into your router, you have mobile data, you can just plug and you have in. Ethernet, right? Like,
what's the deal about Wi-Fi? That.
I mean, I'm assuming the implication is a lot of people say Wi-Fi is shorthand when they mean internet in general.
Yeah, or at that's the very what least, I was wondering,
home internet, but in the literal sense, it's just wireless, and that doesn't hurt me at all.
Yeah.
5149.
Mm-hmm.
The first number, by the way, is always going to be the left option. I don't want to have to explain every single time. Would you rather have 4 hands or 4 feet?
4 hands.
Do I get extra
Maybe
arms?
Maybe if you have 4 feet, you can. Yeah, I would hope so.
That's what I was wondering, well, right? That's like...
It's not quite as handy if you, I mean, well, pardon the pun. It's actually more handy. But if they're on the same wrist, then it doesn't help as much. 4 feet, I guess you could run faster if you can work them really well.
Actually, no. I believe generally centrism is because you want to run faster. So centrism is an evolutionary adaptation where you lose the function of one set of legs, and I think it's usually used to run faster. So actually, I don't think that's how, although I don't know if there's like a limit, if bipeds are necessarily better than quadrupeds, but
saying like quadrupeds in also, general run faster than bipeds.
I mean, yes, but also well, some you probably can outrun most turtles, but not the point.
Yeah. Not true, a fair comparison. True. And maybe a sloth.
I mean,
maybe even a koala.
I was thinking, how fast are elephants? They're probably faster than you think, right? But, yeah, so, I don't know about the other question is then, like, if you have extra legs, like, where do they get attached, right? Because if you still have, like, a vaguely humanoid body plan, then the extra legs would probably just get in the way.
Yeah, exactly.
So I mean, I guess
I'm picking the hands.
I would pick the hands as well, assuming that you get extra arms, because if they're fully functional, it's just very practical.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. 88% of people picked hands.
Yeah. course.
Oof. Would you rather cheat on someone or be cheated on?
Now there is a moral dilemma.
Neither of those seems particularly pleasant, which I guess is the idea.
Yeah, well, I mean, according to some people who don't really have a conscience involved with it.
Yes, some people cheat.
And it also depends on your significant other.
Well, I mean, I don't have one right now, so this is a very abstract question for me anyways.
And whether or not you particularly enjoy being with them. Some people will say, okay, I'll just take the cheat and, you know, go ahead and get this over with anyway.
I almost want to say be cheated on has the advantage that I feel like if I was cheated on, that would be a relationship ender, right? Like, that's just, it's over. Which, I guess it's unpleasant if you like that person, but the other end is like, if you cheat on someone, like, presumably I'm in a relationship with someone because I like them, right? So then we run into a situation where it's like, now I am ruining the relationship, which, and then it's like, I feel like you'd want to try to salvage it, but then it's like, do you want to be with someone that's like accepting of cheaters, right? So that,
exactly.
I feel like being the one cheating has more of a conundrum in it. But I think both of those would be heartbreaking because either one of those could very well break up a relationship that you presumably enjoyed. Hence why you were part in the first place.
Yeah, absolutely.
I guess
if you hide it.
Yeah, but that also sucks, right? Like just from like a.
Yeah. Then it's I would rather be cheated on as long as I didn't know it.
Oh, God. Yeah, but that's also kind of terrible. But yeah, I think I'd probably pick cheated on just because I feel like the consequences logically would be the same, more or less, but at least I didn't do anything bad.
Yeah, you have a free conscience from it. So.
Also, by the way, on an entirely unrelated note, I don't know if I've ever shown this to you. I think it's kind of cool. There's a feature in Windows where you can set your mouse to not be a specific color, like normally where it's like, oh yeah, it's black or white. But when it's always the opposite of the background, which normally means it contrasts. Yeah. So if it on gray, can sometimes disappear, but if I have it on...
Yeah.
On here, it's...
I did not know that was a setting.
Yeah, again, right, sometimes it disappears on gray backgrounds, but otherwise it's like really cool because you can usually find your mouse much more easily. So yeah, we both picked be cheated on, which actually has a slight majority of 56%.
Mm-hmm.
Let's do like two more and then...
Yeah.
Die in 10 years, but happy and with people. Which means plane crash. Amusement park development. See, you're all happy and you're with people. I'm assuming the with people is to contrast with dying 50 years alone and unhappy. I'm assuming the other people don't die in 10 years as well.
Yeah. I mean, is it really worth living if you're alone and unhappy? I mean, if you're an introvert, though.
I mean, and alone maybe, but like unhappy, right? It's like unhappy for 50 years, that sucks.
Yeah, I think the 10 years, yeah.
I'd rather have 10 good years than 50 bad ones, I think. Normally, oftentimes those questions are like, oh, would you rather live alone for a long time or live with people for a short time? It's like, I would pick the alone thing, but...
Yeah.
Alone and unhappy, no.
I think there is a certain mental phenomena that people enjoy depression. Like they almost make it part of their personality. Like, you know, the whole emo culture and whatnot.
Yeah, but I think that they still. I mean, the idea is that they still derive some enjoyment from their life. I do in the abstract sense like the idea of like living, maybe not literally forever, of course, but like. I like the idea of immortality to a degree. I could see myself like choose that if that was an option. So the idea of like choosing a shorter life is inherently contrary to what I believe to some degree about myself. But at the same time, I don't want to be unhappy for an extended period of time just because I live longer, right? Like there's always a question of what's the price, right?
Oh, yeah.
So 80% of people chose 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, would you rather receive $1 million today or $5 million in 10 years, unadjusted for inflation?
Oh, unadjusted. Well, at this rate of inflation, that may be worth $1 million when we get there.
That's what I was thinking. Like, A, it might not be much more, and B, if you actually use it right now, the benefits you derive from it, like, even if you're not, I don't want to go, like, full, like, oh, if you invest $1 million today, then in 10 years, you're going to have $10 million anyways, right? Like, I don't want to go, like, full finance product.
Or you could lose it all.
Because, I mean, you know, government bonds or whatever, there are safe investments that still have decent returns, but, like, spend it, buy a house, right? Like,
yeah.
You never have to pay rent again or something, right? Like, this is...
If you buy a house and then the inflation continues going through the roof, you can just sell the house for much more than you bought it for.
And I mean, again, right? Like, if you do something like buy a house, then you have a lot of more financial stability because you don't have as many running costs as if you rent. Mm-hmm. So there are these things where you can invest the $1 million in, not in terms of like the financial market, but just in your own life in ways that can make your life a lot better and more stable that can then in turn pay itself back in some sense.
Absolutely.
To where I think it's worth it to pick $1 million today.
Yeah, I think so.
People will equate this to like the delayed gratification thing, but I think there are, with money especially, there are often actual practical reasons for why you'd want the money now.
Yeah, because you can also have the gratification later.
58% said money now.
Smart people.
Yeah, I mean... Again, I can see, but it's also if you are like a homeowner with a stable income, I could see why you might, if you assume that the inflation / your interest rates on savings doesn't actually make the $5 million less in 10 years, then I could kind of see like if you don't need it right now, picking it later. But if you can actually use $1 million very well right now, and I'm not talking about like frivolously spending it, but actually like using it, then I do think it should be an easy choice. So I can see why that would split 50-50, maybe not quite 50-50, but how that would split differently depending on whom you ask, because people just have different considerations. I don't think there's like an universally correct choice here.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, if you're well off now, then probably could wait.
Which brings us to our last segment, which is the Songs of the Week. What is your Song of the Week?
Yeah. It is a Sublime with Santeria. Yeah. Sublime was so interesting because they mixed so many genres together, and during a time that wasn't really the thing to do, and it hadn't been done that often. I know there were bands like Led Zeppelin in the past that would try out a new genre on each album, but Sublime, you could literally have one song with three different genres blended, and then you could go to the next track and have three separate genres blended together. It's really amazing that usually those types of things, the extreme avant-garde of it and the experimentation of it doesn't really sell, but somehow Sublime blew up. I mean, a lot of it was the death of Brad Noll also, which played a part because, you know, for some reason, there's just this phenomenon that once an artist dies, their music takes off and all of a sudden everyone was always the biggest fans of them. That did play a part, but it was still... very crazy that Sublime became as big as they were, even before Brad died, because of how they weren't confined to any single genre.
I mean, that's definitely a cool thing. This song in particular doesn't really resonate with me. I mean, I like the instrumentals. I'm not a big fan of the vocals. That's obviously like a taste thing to a degree.
is Sublime too hip hop for you?
Well, I wouldn't even necessarily say that, but I just don't like, again, I just don't like his vocals in this song. Like,
really?
I'm not even sure if I can explain it that well why, but it just doesn't resonate with me.
Oh, okay. Music is subjective.
I mean, I'm also going to say they should be a bit cleaner, but it's not like they're unclean vocals in like the traditional sense. But I don't know. My song of the week is one that you should have, well, that you should be familiar with, I was going to say, that you definitely have heard before. You've had it on the channel. I looked it up. But I picked it before I knew that. But either way, I thought it was kind of cool. And also, in some ways, a bit of an outlier, but we can talk about that after I played it. It's Karate by Baby Metal.
Oh, yeah.
So, Baby Metal, right? They're sometimes considered kawaii metal, which is a very small subgenre. And I think Baby Metal weren't quite the first, but I think they were like one of the first artists that are grouped in a genre to blow up. So,
yes.
In that sense, also a bit of a unique thing. Also, I think they do also sometimes have some like rap and hip hop influences on some of their songs, but definitely not this one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I do like some of that stuff. Not a big fan of some of the other stuff. This is one of those bands for me that, like, when they're good, they're good. But when they're not, not good is in objective terms. But like, you know, when it hits, and otherwise it really doesn't. But this one is probably my favorite song of theirs.
Yeah, another band that has blended very many genres together. If you go back through their first couple of albums. And maybe it was the second album when they started experimenting with it, but there is everything from like Indian folk music blended with metal to hip hop, like BMC is a hip hop metal track. And progressive, like EDM, Dust Till Dawn is probably my favorite track by them of all time. It's amazing. But yeah, they were actually listed as one of the 50 top metal bands of all time by, was it Rolling Stone? I think it was Rolling Stone. I mean, yeah, and it's crazy. It set a lot of people off because, you know, the purists and the traditionalists are like, whoa, you can't have this J-pop metal group thrown in with Metallica and, you know, whoever else. But they were, and I think they deserve it.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, there are only so many people that can do the same thing until it doesn't become interesting, right? And so mixing it up is kind of something. I'm admittedly less familiar with them than you are because I saw that you did an entire series on them which had like 60-some parts. You would know their discography a lot better than I would. I've listened to a couple of songs. There were some that I liked, and mostly the ones with like the rap influences that I heard I didn't like particularly much. Again, that's just my personal taste. But... But yeah, no, I listened to like maybe a dozen of their songs, and there were a couple in there that I liked. And out of those that I know, this is my favorite, but I guess I have some homework to do.
Yeah, they're great, man. They just released a new album the past few months.
How many of them are still left anyways? Because I think one of them left at one point, didn't she?
Yui left, and... They actually, I saw on their last video that they replaced her with someone. I don't know. A lot of these artists came out of the Suguru Gakuen. There was like this talent factory in Japan where they were pumping out these stars, you know, mostly J-pop stars. But
yeah,
they pulled three of the girls to make Baby Metal. But Yui left, and that left Suzuka and Moa. And last I saw, they replaced her. I don't know if it's Kano or who else, but someone else probably from Suguru Gakuen has taken her place. They're back to three now, it seems.
Yeah, I mean, it's fairly normal for the like J-pop and K-pop groups. Like Japan and Korea both have these like these systems where they bring up groups and, you know, the whole idol culture stuff. But
yeah,
I feel like for Baby Metal, it's a little bit different because A, they had their original lineup for quite a while, and also B, there's just three of them. I mean, obviously there's like the band as well, but like in terms of the actual faces of the group, there's just the three of them, which I feel like makes it a bit harder to replace a member. because it's immediately... I mean, I would imagine it's hard to replace Sue. The other two are maybe a little bit easier.
Yes.
Because, I mean, Sue is the lead vocalist, and also, my understanding is that she actually, House of Names actually, like, sings their songs when they perform, which in Japan, it's very, it's not unusual to do playback and then focus more on the performance of it. But she actually actually sings her parts oftentimes actually live, which is, I'm not sure if it's like that much of an outlier in Japan, but it's definitely, she doesn't have to, and I kind of respect that she still does it anyways. And she actually can sing very well too, which obviously you can see on live performance a lot better. Because obviously if it's recorded in studio, you can make anyone sound good. But yeah, no, she's definitely the sort of the core of that group.
Yeah, yeah, and actually, if you go to, I don't remember what award show it was, but there was a live performance with Baby Metal and Rob Halford from Judas Priest.
I saw that.
You've seen that?
Yeah.
Yeah, and actually, Yui and Moa actually played guitars during that live performance.
Okay.
Which is very rare to see any one of the main three playing any instruments, but apparently they can.
I don't recall that specifically, but yeah, I do remember seeing that. I think it was that. It was definitely like one of like the more recognizable sort of Western metal guys singing with them. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, two very interesting and maybe to a degree unique bands that we had in today's Songs of the Week. I mean, after all, this is a bit of a showcase type thing. I mean, I have some of those big songs that like most people know, but you know, it happens. But yeah, I think this does it a little bit better. Do you want to plug everything? Everything, yeah. Do you want to plug anything before we end the show?
Yeah. Yeah, if you want to check out my reactions to a lot of music and also Hollywood, he happens to be there also, then the link is down in the description. If you want to hear me talk about football along with Alex, the link is down in the, I believe it's down in the description, right? Yeah, so check out either one of those and I'll be in your ear all over again.
And that brings this episode of the Trash Talk Podcast to a close. If you enjoyed it, don't forget to leave a like. If you want to see more episodes like this, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. And if you have something to say, leave a comment below or join the Discord links in the description also below. I don't know, maybe it's somewhere else on mobile. But yeah, Smokey. That's it.